Suppose if we take this condition. Now, when we see the table, we will have this value, right? F of 0.75 corresponding is 0.7734. What is the meaning of this? Is so here because it is positive. Here we'll have 0.75, right? 0.75. This one. This is that value. Next, what is the 0.7734 denotes or stands for is the area under the normal curve this side, because the integration is done from minus infinity to this value, right? This value is 0.7734. I think I hope that is clear. Now we want to find the same for minus value. Now I'll take this, say, one more curve, and I'll take 0.75 with minus. That is minus 0.75. So this we are not having this value in the table. So actually, the value corresponding to minus 0.75 means from minus infinity to z, right? That means actually we want this probability, right? This is the value corresponding to minus 0.75, right? Perfect. This value we want, but what we are having is this value. Okay, so from this, how to get this is very simple. Now, this value is 0.7734. Then, what about this value? Because total area is 1 or total probability is 1, and up to this part, it is 0.7734 means this is how much? 1 minus, right? 1 minus 0.774. That is 1 minus f of 0.75. Now, as discussed, because it is symmetric. This tail and this tail both are symmetric. That means whatever the area under the normal curve is here, the same comes here. That means f of minus 0.75 if we take, that is nothing but 1 minus f of 0.75. That means f of minus z equal to 1 minus f of z. Okay? I hope that is clear. Z values are not between minus 1 and 1, it is minus infinity to infinity. Because the tails of the curve is never ending, actually. It never cuts x axis. It goes because x takes all the values from minus infinity to plus infinity. But what we are doing, the spread of all the x values, we are trying to shrink into normal curve, the standard normal curve whose mean is 0 and standard deviation is 1. That is the advantage here. Now, once we are very clear with this concept, very simple, you take any problem. Very simple, maybe we have many descriptions. Finally, if you see this, what is the probability that the reaction time is between 1 second to 1.75 seconds? Very simple, right? Okay. So, what is the probability that x lies between 1 and 1.75? So, here it is clearly mentioned that it is normal distribution. With the mean 1.25 and standard deviation 0.46. Very simple, right? The same. So, one we have to convert, right? One we have to convert in terms of z by using x minus mu by sigma, that is this value. Similarly, 1.75 we have to convert by using the similar approach on x minus mu by sigma, that is 1.09. Then it becomes, right? This is the original problem in terms of x. We converted in terms of z like this. very simple, now there is no integration, nothing, right? Then very simple, f of upper limit, that is 1.09 minus f of lower limit. And we know whenever negatives are there, we'll convert them where we can use positive values, 1 minus f of. Very simple. Yeah, now simply we'll go to the table, we'll see 1.0 and above all, at the top we'll go for 9 and see what is the corresponding value, which is 0.82. Similarly, 0.54 value and then we get this. Now I think normal distribution became very simple, right? No integration, nothing. So how to do a problem? Very simple, right? We will have a problem in terms of x, we need to convert in terms of z by using x minus mu by sigma, then we will get this, then f of upper limit minus lower limit, then we have to take the tables, copy the values, do the calculations, very simple, no integration from anywhere. How the x value changes from where 520. Yeah, that is whenever negative is there, tomorrow no class, there is no class. Yeah, you want that, I'll explain. It's a very simple actually, I think still it is not clear. Negatives I will explain again because many are depression. Now this is actually right, we'll take this. I'm repeating that the negative values related. This. Now this is 0.75 positive, some value. And this is something which is related to negative, same value. So this value will have from the table, right? Suppose it is 0.75. 0.75 suppose. So what we'll have is this, whatever the value that we get from the table is nothing but this shaded portion, right? This shaded portion, right? Till this. Now, whatever the value, 0, whatever it is, 0.657, whatever it is. Now, if you see here, this leftover tail is there, right? This part. What is the value for this curve, this part? What is the value for this part? Now, this is f of 0.75 till now, right? And this is because total area under the normal curve is 1, that is probability is 1. And this value is nothing but f of 0.75. So then it becomes 1 minus f of 0.75. I hope that's clear, right? So this right tail is nothing but 1 minus f of z. Now coming to negative values, this is what we want, right? This value f of minus 0.75 we want, that means this portion we want, right? This portion, right? This portion we want, right? Now if you see, this portion is same as this portion, right? That means this portion we know, this f of 1 minus f of 0.75, therefore this is also 1 minus f of 0.75. So like this we can find the normal values for negative values, that is f of minus z equal to 1 minus f of z. So is it clear, right? Okay. How 5 is changed to minus 0.75, right? Yeah. Where it is? Already we calculated, that's why here you see 5 we converted in terms of z, right, by using x minus mu by sigma, that is minus 0.75. This is what we used here because already we calculated. Already we did in the first part, that's why directly we copied this value. So x value we are converting in terms of z by using x minus mu by sigma. Session is not recording. It's recording actually. Recording. So I hope that is clear, right? Otherwise, also I will face some problems. Is it clear? So normal distribution. This is very important distribution. We are going to use it frequently in inferential statistics. If you are not able to follow anything, let me know. Let me know. I will try to make it more clear with some more examples. And maybe I will record one or two problems with clear explanation and share. But try to be conversant with this distribution. Yeah, it is the one good question. Generally, if you find any z value which is into 4 decimals, 5 decimals, then adjust it to 2 decimals because our table is for 2 decimals, right? Generally equal to 1.02 like this. If any z value with more decimal values, then try to adjust it so that it and bring it to with 2 decimals z value. Then we can use the table. In slide number 20. So now somewhere between if any plus minus difference, just ignore it and try to concentrate on the concept what we have. Maybe I might have missed something in plus minus. So is it clear? Shall we go proceed further for the exam inferential statistics? That's slide 22. I will check. What else if x is already between, even if it is between 0 and 1, we have to, because we have to normalize it. We have to normalize it. We have to normalize. It is slow, yeah. Okay. No, we have to normalize it. Yeah, maybe this week we will plan for one session on combinations, permutations, derivatives, and integration. Definitely. I will keep my promise. Now, all kind of sampling. What is this sampling? So, like, we can discuss about this like anything. Then, right? What is sampling? Where to use? What is the need for it? Like this. So, what is this sampling? So, now I think we are whatever we are doing right. If you already familiar with some kind of machine learning, data mining, etc. stuff. You had a data, then what we had is we'll divide data into two parts, right? One is trained data, test data, right? One is trained data, test data. Not only this, whenever we build a model, whenever we try to build a model, suppose you have data with 1 lakh entries. 1 lakh entries. You want to understand the behavior of the data. Are we going to work with the complete 1 lakh entries? Are we going to do this? Are we going to see all 1 lakh? No, right? Simply what we do is we go for a part of the data, we do the analysis and we arrive at the conclusion, right? That is what we can understand. So it is prevalent technique anywhere and everywhere, from our kitchen to the elections and economic survey, etc. Right? From kitchen to the max. So So this is where we use this concept called as sampling. Can you tell where, when kitchen, where we use the sampling? Can you guess? Rice checking, they are perfect without using cooker. And when we go to taste the food, what, that is nothing but sampling, right? So we are not going to check each grain of it, each part of it, right? Just we will take a small part of it. That is actually the entire philosophy of inferential statistics. Okay? So, naturally, if you want to buy about 10 cases of tomatoes, the ladies, the lady fingers, etc. We are not going to check each and every tomato, right? So what we do is randomly we'll take one or two and we'll see. If they are good, then we assume that the entire part is good. If they are bad, we say that the entire part is bad. Like this is a very important technique we use regularly, which is called as sampling. The same with respect to our opinion polls or exit polls, whatever we do or whatever we talk about, is also comes under, it also comes under sampling. Yeah, cooking. Yeah. Sampling is very tricky. That's why we can't automate it actually. Why it is tricky? Suppose very simple, you are cooking, we are cooking rice without using cooker. Right? Then we took a part of it, and they say that it is completely boiled. But in reality, if you see, it may not be true, right? Because of various reasons, the flame is not uniform, right? We have not stirred it. We have not stirred before taking the sample. Because we have to be very careful when we do the sampling, right? So many things we have to take care of when we use the sampling techniques. Okay. And here are various types of samplings are there. Various types of samplings are there. But as far as applications are concerned, engineering applications are concerned, whatever we use is called as random sampling. So what is meant by random sampling? Random sampling means the sampling elements are selected randomly. Right? So now I will make it, I think if you have gone through the recorded content, then you will understand. Now this is larger part what we want to study. We want to study the nature of this. Right? Performance or taste, whatever it is. This is called as population. So from this what we do is we take a part of it, right? This is what we call the sample. Now this is what we call the entire data, then we take a seed of it, that is the data we took, a part of the data we take out, then we try to build a model on the top of it, that is the sampling we have taken out. Then what we do is we will do whatever the analysis on this part. This is something like rice, part of rice or part of vegetables what we have taken. We try to do all the analysis on this. Then based on that, what we do is we try to comment or conclude about the population. This is called as sampling. Now, in the process of selecting samples, if every element in the population is having equal chance of being selected, then it is called as random sampling. Various types of samplings are there. We are not getting into that actually. So because we are mostly interested into the random sampling, where randomly we select samples. That is, I think maybe when you try to implement any model, randomly selection. You go for, suppose you had data with 1 lakh lines. And you want to build your model with a sample of 1000, right? then simply we'll say seed 1000. Then it randomly select 1000, it do all the calculations whatever we are asking. Next time again if you go and see another seed equal to 1000, again randomly select another 1000 and it goes. So random, that means not that whatever earlier selection we made second time, not that we are going to have the same elements in the sample. Out of 1 lakh, randomly it selects 1000 outside. Right? So that is called as random sampling. Now where we use this? So where we use this actually? So what is our requirement or necessity to go into this? Suppose we will go through the many places later. Now suppose this company claims that the average life of the product is 2 years. How to validate this? That is the problem. Any idea? Any idea? Any input? How to validate this? We'll come to that one actually. How to validate this claim? Or one more example. Now whenever a new vehicle comes into market, new four wheeler or new two wheeler comes into market, I think most of us first look for what? The KMPL, right? What is the KMPL of the bike or the model, right? Later price and the features, additional features, right? So whenever we see an advertisement which says that tomorrow there is a new model which is coming into the market and they say it is going to give 70 KMPL. Right? How they arrived at this? How to arrive at this actually? Are they selling the bike which already used and tested and saying that this bike is going to be 70 KMPL mileage? Am I going to get the used bike? No, right? So how they arrive at this 70 KMPL? Probably they produced 1 lakh bikes of that model. 1 lakh bikes of that model. And they declare that this mileage of this new bike is going to be 70 KMPL. So how they arrive at this? Or how, suppose if they claim the average mileage of this bike is 70 KMPL, how we can believe them, how to validate it? So what do you mean? How they can arrive at this 70 KMPL? Or how can we validate what they say? Just think what to do. Yeah, perfectly. So that means simulation gives actually. Simulation also gives some kind of calculations. It may give some input saying that the probable mileage of this model, but actual reality, right? Then they select some more bikes of this model, right? And they will test it under various conditions. They will test this under various conditions. That means instead of 2 lakh bikes they manufactured, what they do is some number they select, right? Maybe 100 or 150 bikes they select, right? That means what they are doing sampling here. So they are having one claim related to population, that is the mileage of the bike is 70 KMPL is something related to population. They are talking about the entire model, right? That is population. To validate this time, what we are doing, we are selecting 100 or 150 or like that is some concept. Some sample we have to select, then we test this 150. So we'll test these bikes under various conditions. We note down the mileage it gives. Then we arrive at what is the mean of the sampling. or what is the mileage that we get from the sampling. Next is, suppose it is giving 80 kmpl, that is the average mileage 80 kmpl with 3 as standard deviation, right. Now our sample says 80 with plus or minus 3, but actual original value is 70 kmpl, which maybe they come out with a standard deviation of 5 or 6. So that means now the claim we had, that is some information or conclusion or the hypothesis we had with respect to population. To test the population, we have taken the sample and we have done all the analysis on it and we arrived at some values. What is the next step is whether this outcome 80 plus or minus 3 supports their claim or not. Right? That is another important step. That is, not only selecting the sample, doing the sampling, coming out with the sampling output, but also based on the sample output, we have to validate whatever they say. That is called as, this entire process is called as testing of hypothesis. This entire process is called as testing of hypothesis. Is it clear? What is this test? This is one of the important concepts in inferential statistics. The various types of inferences, various types of applications we see when we go up there. Yeah. Is it clear? Just try to understand the basic concept. What is the concept related to testing of hypothesis? Where we use it, right? And what is the process involved in it? Next comes, what are the tools or what is the procedure to be followed? Now, just I will go to some examples only. We are not going to see how to solve it, just to understand the relevance of the sampling and testing of hypothesis in that context and see what is the difference or the similarity between one example to the other example. Just we will go through it. Right? Next we will see how to solve it. That is, first important step is understanding the scenario. Right? Then discussion, then solving. Now you should see here. And see whether sampling is involved in the process or not. A telecom service provider claims that individual customers pay on an average 400 rupees per month with a standard deviation of 25. This is. Now, what is this actually? They are saying something related to population, right? This is something related to population. So, generally, when this happens is when they go for some concession with the government, they will go with claims like this. They will go with claims like this, right? So what they are claiming is, on an average, an individual pays 400 rupees per month with a standard deviation of 25. Not only that, actually, based on this, you can go for various tariff plans. Now, whether whatever they say is right or wrong, so how we validate, then we took a sample. So a random sample of 50 customers we took. Right? This is sampling. So larger population we had, from which we took a sample of 50, and we have done all the calculations where we got mean is 250, standard deviation is 50. Now what they are saying is 400 per month with a standard deviation of 25, and what we are getting from the sample is 250 with a standard deviation of 15. Right? Now, our next job is how to validate this. Okay? This is one example. And if you see here, what is the approach they have used is the entire conclusion, hypothesis, or claim is based on mean, right? Average calls, average amount spent. That means it is claim related to mean, that is average spending by the customer. With a standard deviation. So we are not going to discuss how to solve it, just try to understand what is population, what is population related information, and what is the next step, that is sampling. So what is the sample, sample size, and what is the beyond data. Next, second one. Second one is almost same, but only difference is, if you see here, what is the difference between the previous one and this one? They are very clear in saying it is exactly 400 rupees per month with standard deviation. And in this case, what they say is, see here. What is the difference here? At least 400. 400 can be, it can range up to 500 or 800 also. This is another example. So there exactly they are saying mean equal to 400 and here at least 400. Now third one. If you see this example here also the same thing, right? But the difference if you see here they have taken a sample with 20 customers. So if you see the previous one, here they have taken a sample with 50 customers. Here also they have taken a sample with 50 customers. So 50 here also 50, here also not 50, here it is 20. Three cases. Later we'll discuss how to do it. Just try to understand the scenarios which fits into this discussion. Next. What about this? So this is another claim. Generally, I think you might have heard most of this. When you go to a college, when you go to a coaching center, they say last time out of 500, 200 students got seats in purchases in his course. Right? So that's why we are the best in the city. Right? Okay? Now, if you see that from the data availability, is observed that 400 out of 850. Purchased the groceries online. Out of 850, 400 opted for online purchasing. Based on this, can we say that people are moving towards online shopping even for groceries? Or reverse? Reverse in the sense, someone says and claims that nowadays people are not going to markets, they are sitting at home and purchasing everything online. This is the claim what they are doing. This is the claim what we are doing. Then what we do to test this claim, we go for sampling. We go for sampling and do the sample analysis. Then we will try to comment on whatever they say. This is sometimes claim followed by sampling. Sometimes you have the sampling, from that you have the conclusion or the claim. So what is the difference between this and this? Any observation? Here if you see, what is the tool or the term that they use to do the sampling? Mean is the tool they have used here. Right? Mean of sample they have got, and based on that they will try to validate mean of the population. In this scenario, it is not a mean actually, it is what actually, out of 850, 400 got this, therefore this is the claim. This is called as proportion, what we call it. I'll repeat. So this is actually, this entire process is called as testing hypothesis. Hypothesis means claim actually. Hypothesis means claim. Next, whenever we had a claim or hypothesis, what we have to do is we have to validate it. How we validate? We take a sample. So to validate the hypothesis, what we do is we go for sampling. Then based on the sampling or sample outcome, we try to validate the claim that is related to population. That is actually testing of hypothesis. So in that various scenarios like what we have been seeing, one is we had hypothesis related to mean life or average life, average mileage of the bike, etc. That is one type of. This second scenario is proportion. Out of 850, out of 800 studied in the coaching center, 400 got
into prestigious institutes. Then they claim that one ours is the best institute. This is the claim. Here, what is the tool that they have used is proportion. Proportion is the tool which they use to have it claim. Next. Now this scenario. Suppose you are working with two teams, team A and team B. So where they are doing the coding. Okay. And the first team wrote 100,000 lines of code, in which you we identify 250 errors or 250 bugs. And the second team wrote 800 lines of code, and out of which we found 300. Right. Now we had team A, team B. So we had some information related to team A, some information related to team B. Now we'll try to compare these two. Can we assume that team B performance is superior to that of team A? This is another scenario. Right? So if you see, what is the difference between the earlier discussion and this discussion? We had two populations. Population 1, population 2, and in every population we are doing sampling with the help of proportion here, 250 by 1000 here, and here 300 by 800. So we had some sample 1 here, sample 2 here, then we want to compare the population. This is a general application, right? You will have two products, we want to compare the two products. Then we do sampling and we will try to arrive at sampling outcomes related to population 1. Similarly, we do it for the sample 2, then we try to come out with a conclusion. This is another scenario. Now, next one more. Following is the record of number of accidents that took place at a certain place during various weekdays, Monday to Saturday. These are the accidents took place, 120, 140, etc., etc. Now, based on this, I claim that the number of accidents took place is not depending on the day. Something like a Monday, Tuesday, most of the accidents took place, kind of assumption if I had. And by taking this data, I want to validate where it is right or wrong. This is another example. I hope that's clear, right? So some data what we had, based on the data we are coming out with a conclusion. Data what we had is nothing but sampling here in this case. Based on the sample analysis, we are going to comment on something related to population. This is here. In this case, this is sample, right? On a particular week we selected, and we have data where Monday how many accidents, Tuesday in a month. We took the data. In a month, Mondays how many accidents, Tuesdays how many, like this we have. Now based on this, we want to generalize it. This is the population related information. Whether this data supports this claim or not. So that is called a testing of hypothesis. This is the hypothesis, this is the data, and we'll test the data to validate the hypothesis. Many years, right? This is another famous example. So from the hospital we have the data like the smokers and non-smokers. And you had like with the cancer, that is with the cancer and they are smokers, non-smokers but still can have cancer. Similarly without cancer but they are smokers, like this. Some data we have from the hospital records. Now, based on this, can we validate that smoking causes cancer or not? So these are the scenarios. I hope that it is clear. Now, how to do the validation that comes next? Try to understand various scenarios where we need to go for testing of hypothesis.
that once we get into the types of problems and what are the techniques available